Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Catarina, and I'm an environmental economist. That means that this is my object of study. In most of my adult life, I focused on environmental issues and mainly in water management models. But all my life, I have been a gardener. When I was a child, I would steal my mother's Tupperwares. We live in an apartment in the city. And I would steal my mother's Tupperwares and fill them with any soil I could find and drop little seeds into them. There is nothing quite as magical as taking an apparently lifeless thing, putting it in soil, and watching it bloom. So that was hooked. But soil does a lot more for us than just support the growth of our plants. Soil is quite literally the foundation on which we stand. Soil catches water, filters it, stores it, and distributes it when you need it. Soil recycles nutrients and decomposes organic waste, and it's also a key element of both the carbon cycle and the nitrogen cycle, thus a key element of solving climate change and global pollution problems. So if soil is so important, you would figure that economists focus their work on soil? No, not really. In fact, some classical economists a couple hundred years ago did worry about soil in food production. Many of you might know that Malthus wrote a very famous essay on the principles of population where he was worried about the finitude of land. And the idea is land is fixed. So if you want to make food out of it, you have to work the land, you get some output. If you keep working the land, adding more and more workers, you get more food, but less than proportionally. So Malthus essentially concluded that population growth will always be faster than food production. And therefore, we are all eventually doomed to starvation. Not very positive, right? But during the 20th century, many scientists worked on trying to overcome these constraints that Malthus had pointed out, in particular by inventing new machinery, such as tractors, of course, running on fossil fuels, that work the land, irrigation, if it's needed in your climate, and most importantly, chemicals, lots and lots of chemicals. And what happens when you do this is actually you need fewer workers and you get a lot more food. So we have soil. What happens now in modern agriculture, you test the soil. You look for 17 chemical elements that have been identified as essential for plant growth. You add them to your soil. You buy them in little packages. You add them to your soil and boom, you have food. If anything, anything attacks your plants or damages your plants in any way, what do? You poison it. That's how modern agriculture works. It works in the sense that yields have increased all over the world. And in fact, we can now aspire to the zero hunger goal. This is a sustainable development goal number 2 for year 2030. So in a sense, we've overcome Malthusian limitations. However, not everything is going well with soil in the world. In 2015, the UN declared the International Year of Soils. And the International Year of Soils was a wake-up call for many people because different results started coming out, such as 33% of the land that we own on the planet is degraded due to many things, erosion, salinization, compaction, acidification, chemical pollution. 25 to 35 billion tons of fertile topsoil are lost every year. And most of it is not replaced. That is the definition of unsustainable. If we keep this up, if we keep up what we've been doing in modern agriculture, we might lose 1/5 of arable lands in the next 100 years. Are you worried yet? Should be. Let's learn a little bit more about soil to see how we can overcome this. What is unhealthy soil? So if you look at any textbook on soil, this is the typical soil composition. Lots of minerals, air, water, and a little sliver of organic matter, maybe less than 5%. You might think organic matter is not that important to soil, but I'm here to tell you that trying to understand soil without studying its biology is like trying to understand a city without studying its people. The soil is made by the living organisms that dwell there. There is a very complex and very intricate soil food web that makes the soil what it is. How does this work? Well, plants can make their own food from sunlight through photosynthesis. You all know that. But everyone else on the planet cannot make their own food So how do we feed ourselves? How do other living beings feed themselves? First, of course, they eat others. So that's the food chain. You knew that. Second, some of them eat debris from other living beings. So they eat dead tissues. But there's a third way, which is very interesting, actually, for me as an economist. You can trade for your food. Plants actually save some of the sugars that they produce and then take them to their roots and exchange them for other nutrients with microorganisms that live in the soil. So the soil that you see, the healthy soil that you see, is made by this complex chain of living organisms. In the next two slides, I'm going to show you some of the organisms that live in the soil. But first, let me tell you this. Did you know that there are more living organisms in one teaspoon of soil than there are humans on Earth? That's true. Literally, billions of individuals are living in one teaspoon of soil. Thousands of species are living in one teaspoon of soil. Ignore that, and everything you do is going to be wrong. Let me show you some of the organisms that make soil so special, starting with some pictures that I took, so obviously a little bigger than things that can fit in a teaspoon. Mushrooms. You've all seen mushrooms. Mushrooms are the part that you can see of fungi that live inside the soil. Millipedes, or earthworms as well. Both of these are important soil engineers because they make tunnels, and through these tunnels, air can get through the soil, and plants can feed themselves better. Ants, also very important, especially in drier climates. They also have a very important role in working out the soil structure. And spiders, and scorpions, and toads, and of course, lots and lots of flowers, and even the occasional bunny. All of these are soil-dwelling organisms. But these are the ones we can see. The ones that live in every single little bit of soil are mostly the ones that we cannot see. So of course, I didn't take these pictures. I'm going to show you some images from the Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas. This is an actinobacteria. Do you know what this is? It's called Streptomyces verticillus. A bit strange. You may never have heard of it, but actually a lot of useful substances come from this bacterium. In particular, there's an antibiotic you might have heard of. It's called streptomycin. The name comes from this bacteria. Also, you may never have seen this bacteria, but I'm pretty sure you've smelled it. Have you ever gone out after the rain and smelled that smell of like fresh earth, like really sweet, sort of making your heart feel big? That's geosmin, earth odor. And guess who produces that smell? Actinobacteria. The second picture here is the root of a plant, of a legume plant. And legume plants, they have this interesting association with rhizobacteria. These little orange nodules are bacteria that they can take nitrogen from the air and give it to the plant. Why would you need chemicals? The nitrogen is always around you in the atmosphere. They can take that and give it to the plant. Now, here's just some more assorted microorganisms just to give you an idea of the variety. And then I want to stop here and talk a little bit more also about this one. This is another plant root. And again, when you look at it, what is going on there? It's a marketplace. The plant is feeding its host. The host plant is feeding sugars. And the mycorrhizal fungi, in this case, it's not a bacteria, it's a fungus. The mycorrhizal fungi is feeding itself with its sugar and giving macronutrients to the plant in return. 80% of the Earth's plant species produce this type of association with mycorrhizal fungi. So that's how important mycorrhizal fungi are. Now let's look at some fauna, so some animals. These are nematodes. Have you ever heard of nematodes? One out of every five animals on Earth is a nematode. There's nematodes of all types. There are nematodes that eat nematodes. There are nematodes that eat bacteria, nematodes that eat fungi, nematodes that eat plants. There's even fungi that catch nematodes, capture them, and then eat them, decompose them, and thus protect their host plants from nematode attacks. So all this complexity is happening right beneath your feet. This is a rotifer. Now, rotifers, they do this really nifty trick. When environmental conditions are too extreme, They actually slow down their metabolism, and they can hold on for years with no activity. And as soon as conditions come back to where they want it to be, in a couple of hours, they're off. They're living their life again. Very cool. Tardigrades. Tardigrades are known to be the toughest animals on Earth. They've actually survived in outer space. And springtails. Springtails are very, very common. In a 1 square meter of good natural woodland or grassland, you can find 40,000 individuals of these. And this is why, when you think about Sustainable Development Goal number 15, which is about supporting life on land and supporting biodiversity, you should very much be thinking about biodiversity within the soil, because 25% of the Earth's biodiversity is in soil ecosystems. So that's what we need to be focusing on. Now, soil is very complex. The more biodiversity is, the more stable it becomes, the more resilient it becomes to shocks, and therefore, the more the relationships between the different organisms can survive and can provide new production for us as well in our food. Now, in a very complex and healthy ecosystem such as soil, there is competition, yes, there is predation, yes, but there's also symbiosis, and there's also complementarity, and every species has a role to play. And you thought economics was complicated. Now, how far do you think we're going to get in agriculture if we keep focusing on only 17 chemical elements, given that what's really making the soil come to life is this variety of species? So let's end our presentation by thinking about what we can do to not treat soil like dirt. Soil is alive. Don't treat it like dirt. There's many things that you can do at several levels. So in terms of action, if you're a policymaker, what can you do? Well, first, stop subsidizing things that kill the soil. Please do not think that you can clean your forests by cutting everything out. That's not good for the soil, obviously. Stop harmful practices. Stop subsidizing farmers or mandating farmers that they have to plow their land. Second thing that governments should do, of course, is to regulate and tax harmful substances. Anyone that damages the environment should be paying for those damages. This is the polluter pays principle, and it's been well established in international law. Third, you need to respect natural processes and natural regeneration, because that's the way you go beyond the recovery that we have now. Finally, governments need to support biodiverse land use, so fight monocultures, and also support soil science, which has taught us so much in the past couple of decades. Now, I'm assuming not many of you are policymakers in the government, but some of you might be farmers. Anyone? I'm a farmer, right there. That's me on my tractor. Anyone else farming here? Any farming experience? Farming family? No? No, not really? Ah, some farming families. Okay. So what can farmers do? Farmers are, of course, the main producers of food for humans. This is an essential role. Farmers have an essential role to play. Here's a list of do's and don'ts. I'm not going to go through it. All of these are very well established by now. Good practices. I'm going to summarize them in just three simple ideas. Soil wants to be covered, not bare. Soil wants to be left alone, not torn apart. And soil wants to be alive, not dead. So if you keep those three things in mind, you will be a much better farmer, and you will have a much better chance of protecting the future. Of course, we saw that not that many people are farmers either, so you're thinking, oh, this is all very interesting and all, but what's in it for me? What do I get out of this talk? What do I get out of this presentation? Well, many of you, I'm guessing, might have access to a garden of any size, no matter how small. Imagine how many microorganisms, how much life you can sponsor in your garden. Unfortunately, most gardens in the city look like this. A lawn, manicured lawn. Lawn is a very poor ecosystem. Why? Because it's not diverse at all. And also, it's a high maintenance system. You have to water it, you have to mow it, you have to clean it, you have to fertilize it, you have to throw chemicals at it, and it still looks pretty bad, honestly. When you throw chemical fertilizers at your plants in your garden, those little blue balls that you see there, what are you doing? You think you're feeding your plants. That's why you put them there. But what you're actually doing is you're breaking up the relationships between the plants and the microorganisms that used to feed it its nutrients. When you do that, those microorganisms die because they're not getting any food from the plant anymore. The plant is not feeding them anymore. So when you stop fertilizing, the plant no longer can grow because the microorganisms that used to support it are now dead, thanks to you. You do not need to feed your plants. Soil feeds your plants if the soil is healthy, if the soil is doing well. Leave the leaves. It's fall now. Trees drop their leaves. Don't take the leaves away. The leaves are going to support a next generation of life on your garden. Don't do this. Don't keep the soil bare. These are, by the way, incidentally, all taken in the building I live in Lisbon. I don't have a lot of influence on the garden, as you can see. Of course, many people, when they're faced with this kind of your urban garden, they will go, oh, well, this is just too much effort and too much trouble. And I just want something that looks green and doesn't bring me that much of a headache. So what do people nowadays do? Artificial lawns. Yes, they look green. But what you're doing, essentially, is you're layering plastic on top of an ecosystem. And everything that lives beneath this plastic is dead now. Can we please stop trying to kill things in our gardens, please? There's an alternative. This is my garden in Mertula, in the spring, of course. Mertula is a very tough climate. It gets really, really hot in the summer, and there's not a lot of water. So how can we have a garden in a climate like that? Well, use the native plants. They're adapted to that climate. Also, if a plant grows there that you didn't sow, other people would say, that's a weed. I don't say it's a weed. I'm saying, oh, cool, here's a plant I didn't have to worry about. Let them be. Let them grow. You can still get fruit from your garden, and you can get herbs from your garden, and you can even enjoy the butterflies and the bees and the ladybugs that come to your garden. So here's my final message to you. Let nature back into your garden and into your life. It will reward you again and again, and you will be much happier if you are connected to the soil web that feeds you. Thank you.